Famously frigid Lake Superior is warming quickly, and a recent documentary explores the ways that change will affect people and natural systems.
When describing Lake Superior, you really can't go overboard with superlatives. It's spectacular, rugged, and powerful. Some even describe it as an inland sea. Yet despite its immense size, Lake Superior remains vulnerable. In November 2023, filmmaker John Shepard of Hamline University's Center for Global Environmental Education released a documentary about the impacts of climate change on the lake.
I think the story that we were able to uncover about the warming of Lake Superior has really broad relevance. So our film, A Sea Change for Superior, The Warming of the World's Largest Lake, examines the fact that Lake Superior, the largest lake in the world by surface area, is now among the fastest warming of the world's largest lakes.
Bob Sterner is the director of the Large Lakes Observatory at University of Minnesota, Duluth.
Lake Superior is known as a cold lake for a good reason. And most of the lake water, no matter what's going on with the atmosphere and the sun and everything, most of the lake water is deep and is roughly 4 degrees Celsius, so just over freezing point. One of the things, though, that is changing surprisingly rapidly in Lake Superior is the summer water temperature is going up really, really fast, faster than the overlying air.
To understand why, we need to examine the vanishing winter conditions around Lake Superior. According to Deanna Erickson, director of Lake Superior National Estuarine Research Reserve, during winter, ice typically acts as an insulator, which keeps the lake cold.
It's like a lid on top of the water. And so when that lid is there, it's often white because it's got snow on it, and it's reflecting light back out into the atmosphere. And that white lid keeps the Great Lakes cooler underneath.
But global warming brings warmer winters, and that's changing traditional weather patterns in the region.
The last couple of years, there's been virtually no ice whatsoever. So when there are winters with very little ice cover, the sun is just, the sun's rays and energy are just going right into the water and warming the water through the winter. So that's a significant impact.
To illuminate the dramatic warming of Lake Superior, Shepard's film features a record-setting open water swim by a team of 6 world-class marathon swimmers.
So the day is here. How are you feeling right now?
I'm super excited. The water is a great temperature. I guess I didn't get a read on it. I heard it was maybe 65 even.
They swam nonstop from Split Rock Lighthouse, into which is 46 miles from Duluth. They swam from there all the way to Duluth, nonstop over about a 24-hour period. As it turned out, they were able to complete the swim, and the water the whole time they were swimming was never colder than 60 degrees, which is extraordinary.
I also love the story of people swimming in the lake, because it really sticks a pin in the changes that we're seeing. It marks it in this very tangible human way, and I really appreciate that.
While warmer water might sound appealing, it actually creates challenges on the lake. Experts worry that invasive species, which flourish in warm water, might become an issue. And commercial fishermen, like Stephen Dahl, who's been fishing herring in the lake for over 30 years, say the warm water creates rough currents that make their job increasingly dangerous.
Cold is beautiful. Uniformly cold water out there, no trouble. The top water gets warm. It'll get up to 60, 65 degrees, you know, and it's 39 degrees down in the bottom. So you get some really weird currents. And quite often, we see it, wind's one way and currents another way. So when the net comes up, it'll start spinning on you, or or the net will be way out there in front of the bow, and the wind's pushing you back the other way. And frightening sometimes. When the water's cold and uniformly cold, you don't get those problems. You don't get the currents.
Experts also believe that climate change contributes to extreme weather around Lake Superior.
There have been three 500-year or 1,000-year storm events within a six-year period that impacted Duluth and the south shore of Lake Superior, Wisconsin, and the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. And the destruction of those storms was incredible.
On top of damage to infrastructure and homes, scientists believe that these storms triggered a new issue in the region. A few weeks after the first storm hit in 2012, scientists recorded the first ever algal bloom on Lake Superior.
The attitude then was, wow, that was weird. Maybe it has to do with the rainstorm, and I hope we never see it again. But what has happened is we have seen these blooms again since.
The appearance of blooms doesn't seem to be a coincidence. Big storms produce large amounts of nutrient-rich floodwater, which overflows into Lake Superior. And when that happens during warm months, conditions are ripe for algal blooms.
Those blooms often happen in conditions where it's warmer and there's more nutrients. So we've got more nutrients from floods, and we've got warmer conditions as the atmosphere is warming around us.
Algal blooms can spell trouble for the lake. Although they only last for a short period of time, they produce a bright green scum that sits on the water's surface, and it can be harmful to humans and other creatures.
Algal blooms are a big human health concern because often, not always, but often algal blooms can carry concerning levels of toxins.
It's important to understand the changes that are happening to Lake Superior as a whole because of the impact those changes have on our lives. I hope when audiences see this film that they feel lucky to know about Lake Superior, that they experience a little bit of the awe and the beauty of the place and the importance of the place on a global scale, but that they also feel motivated to support researchers, scientists, institutions, natural resource professionals, and others who are really working, often on public funds, to care for these places. Because when we're doing that, we're trying to do it for all of us. And not just all of us humans, all of us living things around the Great Lakes. And we need people's support for that.
Temperature is a kind of a master variable for many things. And so if we're talking about warm versus cold, that has an impact on almost everything that's going on in the lake. There's a lot more science that needs to be done here than we have available today.